Thank you very much for braving this dreich weather, as we would say back in Scotland. So just when you might think that, as the word dreich would imply, bleak, despair, miserable, darkness, and so on, there is a ray of hope in our three guests this morning who are going to talk about Iron Dome and the lessons for the United States of America. And starting from my far left, we have Tom Carrico, who is a visiting fellow with the International Security Program at the Project on Nuclear Issues at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. And he's also a professor at the Kenyon College. And then in the middle here, we have Michaela Dodge, who's a policy analyst with the Defense and Strategic Policy Department at the Heritage Foundation. And she's also currently pursuing her doctoral degree in political science at George Mason University. And she has a rather large bio that would probably spend about 45 minutes going through, but to say that Michaela is very accomplished would be an understatement. And then last, but certainly not least, on my immediate left, we have Rebecca Heinrichs, who is our fellow at the George C. Marshall Institute, formerly visiting fellow at the Heritage Foundation and the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies, and is also currently vice chairman of the Counterproliferation Working Group of the John Hay Initiative. And she has also formerly served as an advisor on military affairs and foreign policy to Representative Trent Franks of Arizona. So we'll let Tom talk first, followed by Michaela, followed by Rebecca, and we'll then open the floor to questions and answers. So first of all, Tom Carrico of CSIS, thank you very much.
Thank you, John, and thank you, Marshall Institute. There was a debate just before we came up here about whether it was Scottish weather or English weather, but thankfully it's still British weather, either way. So we're talking about Iron Dome. It's an important system, it's an important concept, and it seems to be seems to have been remarkably successful. And what I want to do is make about five or so points about really what it represents. And let me just list them off for you here. One, of course, is a class question. That really what we're talking about is a CRAM thing, a counter rockets, artillery, and mortars, which of course is a different animal than the usual BMD things we talk about. Talk a little bit about the threats that were Iron Dome faced and countered in the 2014 exchange. How all this fits into some larger threat and technological trends. I won't bury the lead on this. I'm going to suggest that missiles are back. What this means for BMD technology more generally, questions of deterrence and escalation control, and finally I want to say something about the U.S.-Israeli partnership and U.S. foreign aid related to Iron Dome. So as folks know, and since I'm going first, I'll say a little bit about this, of course, that Iron Dome really is designed as a CRAM, short-range rockets that it's countering, maybe 155-millimeter, maybe a little bit larger than that, rockets and artillery type of things. It uses, of course, the Tamir missile with a small explosive on it, of course. One feature of Iron Dome, and I'll emphasize this as a technological thing, that it's capable of looking at a lot of different threats simultaneously. And going forward, any missile defense system of any range is going to need to have that capability. This, of course, is part of a system of layers for Israel. We've got David's Sling, which is comparable to older versions of Patriot. I think it's called the Stunner, with a 70 to 250-kilometer range. And then you've got your Endo Aero 2 and your Exo Aero 3 capabilities. Part of Iron Dome's appeal lately, of course, is its high kill rate. Some folks will say 85% this last time around. Uzi Rubin will say something more than that, and maybe it is. But at any rate, it does seem to be remarkably successful. On the threat side, you really are looking at the very short-range Qassams, Katushas, Grads, and up. Notably, on the threat side, as we've seen in this past exchange, that courtesy of Iran, we now see not merely missiles, but missile production centers within Gaza of these RAM production lines, both Hamas and Islamic Jihad. So they've got parallel centers there. That's remarkable. It's also part of, you might say, a larger proliferation pattern. For the folks who like to stress that China doesn't proliferate as much as it used to, they don't need to. They were giving, of course, whole missiles to Pakistan back in the 90s, but when you and Iran, but now, of course, they've transported the missile production system, so you don't need to ship whole missiles from China anymore. And I think that's what we might be looking at with Gaza and perhaps beyond. This past summer, July 8 to August 26, some 4,500 rockets or so were fired from Gaza. About 2,200 fell just outside of the Gaza Strip. Of these, 775 were intercepted, and there were two deaths in Israel as a result of that. There were some six Iron Dome batteries stood up. In Tel Aviv, one rocket made it through, but some 66 were intercepted out of 134 total. In Ashdod, some 15 leaks, 371 that were fired, and 170 intercept for that particular area. And the two deaths, of course, is quite a bit less than the five in 2012 against out of 1,600 rockets, and the 53 fatalities in 2006 when there were 4,300 rockets. And of course, it was the 2006 war, the 2006 deaths that really contributed to the rise of Iron Dome. There were also some UAVs in the mix in 2014. Some 10 of them sent from Hamas, two or three of them reportedly shot down, probably with Patriot, and one from Syrian territory. One of the main features that I'll mention now and bring up again later is cost. The cost exchange ratio between offensive and defensive. For the foreseeable future, we may get to railguns and directed energy, but for right now, we're still with kinetic. And the cost of kinetic interceptors still is much higher than what it costs for a Hamas rocket maybe made with some sugar and some chemicals to do. That's just a fact. But the nice thing about Iron Dome is that it's much lower than some of the alternatives. Now let me say a little bit about the threat picture more broadly and where this fits. Where it fits within the threat and within, say, trends. About 10 or 11 years ago, there was a paper, I think by Carnegie, entitled The Declining Missile Threat. And there was some truth to that at the time. You might say that there was a kind of a five-year lull around that time in terms of foreign ballistic missile development. But if that was true in 2003, it doesn't seem to be true any longer. A couple years ago, Paul Bracken wrote a book called The Second Nuclear Age. I'll suggest in a way, we're still at the beginning of a new missile age. And I'm not just talking about ballistic missiles. We're seeing, I think, a surge, not merely on the ballistic missile development, say Iran and North Korea, UNHA, and especially the solid rocket motor development, which is tremendous, but other kinds of missile threats and missile developments. Land attack cruise missiles that Dennis Gormley's been talking about for so many years. Not just China, but of course also Russia, and as most notably with the GLICM INF-prescribed missile reported this past year, finally. But also Pakistan, Iran, South Korea, Taiwan. Our allies, too, are looking more and more about cruise missile capabilities. Saudi Arabia. Likewise, anti-ship missiles, anti-ship ballistic missiles and cruise missiles. Not just China, but Iran. Hezbollah, you may recall, used one of these against Israel in 2006. But it's more than that. There's also, of course, the DF-21 kind of capability that China's pursuing. But I want to also lump in here anti-aircraft, right? That in this new surge of missile capability, there's folks that worry about the disappearance of stealth, that might go away, and that the unique capability the United States has enjoyed with stealth could be significantly degraded. And that has a lot to do with the development of radars, which is tremendous with Iron Dome and everything else, but also with the interceptors themselves, the S-300 class, 400, 500 evolution that you see in Russia and elsewhere. And there's also this development and this increased development of small, increasingly prolific, and probably cheaper short-range stuff. And what Gaza used this past time around had more significant range, of course, than it did in 12 and 6. Everybody talks about A2AD, anti-access area denial, but a big part of A2AD is missiles. And so I'd like to put all this in that larger picture. Now, to what extent now does Iron Dome's success, relative success, how does that translate to other realms of missile defense? And I think my colleagues may speak a little bit about that. Let me flip that question around as well. To what extent has missile defense success in other fields helped Iron Dome, right? Again, this is a relatively new thing, that there are those folks that have never met a missile defense system they didn't hate, but it is in part the development of the radars and the interceptors and the miniaturization of all that that I think has contributed and will continue to contribute, trickle down to this CRAM capability to lower the cost and to encourage the proliferation of defensive systems like this to our allies, right? I could see a system like Iron Dome, I say like Iron Dome for the concept, being of interest, say, somewhere with a similar threat profile like the Korean Peninsula. But you also see with Iron Dome some success in battle management control, right? That the kinds of capabilities, the kinds of exercise and practices that you've seen in the larger, more heady, exo-atmospheric kind of stuff is going to be trickling down and has trickled down to this. And I emphasize the concept. I'm not flacking for Iron Dome or one particular system, but it's. I think you're going to see a lot more of this low-tier, cheaper systems, whether it's on ships, the Phalanx, whether it's something like Iron Beam or Thel. At the lower tier, you've got things like Avenger, the SAMT in France. The line begins to blur here between anti-air and anti-missile and all these kinds of things, and I think you're going to see more of that. We may see UAV-mounted sensors, like what Phantom Eye, or you may see UAV-mounted kinetic and directed energy interceptors. So I would look for all of that, as well as air-launched hit-to-kill. You can put an interceptor on a manned aircraft as well. Let me say something about deterrence. Did missile defense work on the deterrent side with Iron Dome, right? Lots of missiles were fired. Lots of rockets were fired. The fact the high success rate did not appear to deter Hamas from keep lobbing them over there, right? Now, you could say, well, they had a relative success by continuing to drain U.S. and Israeli resources, because even at their low cost, Iron Dome still costs more than these little rockets. That's possible. Is it the case that we might get to a point of defense, true defense dominance, not merely at the low tier, but at higher tiers? Maybe. We're not there yet. The fact that there were only two deaths in 2014, though, as opposed to 53 in 2006, is there a point at which it may discourage these things to be lauded at Israel? Maybe, maybe not. There is a question of volume there, and you can never have probably a perfect defense. So that's skeptical, especially if you think there were larger political questions that they were trying to, political objectives that they were trying to accomplish, more than merely blowing up Israeli buildings. Let me come to my final point, and that's the U.S.-Israeli partnership and foreign aid. The U.S. and Israel, of course, are very important partners. And let's be candid, Iron Dome wouldn't exist today were it not for years and decades of American technology advancement and cooperation on these systems. But I also want to raise a contrarian question about the U.S.-Israeli relationship. I'm as pro-Israel as the next person, and I am all for boosting inventory, for example, of Iron Dome and these kinds of things. But I want to raise a question about what we saw this summer on this. And this was, I think, in July. You saw a very successful system, and then you saw a call for the replenishment of the inventory. And I'll just suggest it was a little peculiar that so many members of Congress were tripping over one another to see who could up the spending for Iron Dome the fastest and the highest. It was the only bill you could get out of Congress. We couldn't do the border. We couldn't do anything else. But you had folks tripping over each other, trying to spend money for Israeli missile defenses as quickly as possible. We're going to go, again, another round of playing chicken on the NDAA this year. And some of the same folks who were quite happy to throw money at this, rightly, I'll suggest, are quite happy to have sequestration and are quite happy to slash the defense budget and, frankly, are quite happy to cut U.S. missile defense funding. And I think there's something a little perverse about that. So I think a lot of folks here would be pro-Iron Dome. I'm pro-Iron Dome. But I also want to suggest there's some questions to be answered about the disconnect between our relative support for programs like this and some other things, including the American defense budget and U.S. missile defense. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. And next we have, speaking on this issue, we have Michaela Dodge from the Heritage Foundation. Michaela, the floor is yours.
What I'm going to focus on in my remarks is the context from which the Iron Dome was born, as to give you feel a little bit for what it's like for Israel and how they came to rally around the system that protects them today. In 2006, Hamas fired rockets and anti-tank missiles on Israeli civilians, attacked civilian population targets, and attacked Israeli soldiers on the border with Lebanon. Now, imagine that you are in your house and about 30 times a day you hear sirens go off. And each time you have to pack your family, grab your kids, and go to your basement and or go to the nearest shelter. And that happens for days. And by the way, God forbid that you are further than 30 seconds away from that shelter. Now, the terror that the Israelis experience is nothing comparable to what we have in the United States. And quite predictably, the Israeli population exercised great pressure on the Israeli government to put this to a stop. And so the Israeli government launched a counteroffensive during which about 150 Israeli soldiers died. That's a large number of casualties for a country like Israel. Now, fast forward 5 years later. In about 2 weeks in November 2011, Hamas again launched about 1,000 short-range rockets, mortars, and artillery shells to Israel, trying to replicate what they did in 2006, and trying to induce the Israeli government to hastily react. And the Hamas actually increased the rate at which it fired rockets as the time progressed. Now, the Hamas terrorists hardened their positions. They prepared booby traps. They are no fools, and they were prepared for the counteroffensive. But the situation in 2011 is a little different. The Israeli government developed and deployed the Iron Dome system. And again, it's air defense, short-range rocket defense. It's not long-range missile defense. It's a different kind of system. But it helps us to understand conceptually what could happen if we decided, or what are the lessons for the United States. Back then, the system intercepted between 80 to 90% rockets, missiles, and shells that were, again, threatening targets of value and mostly population centers. The system was so successful that people, instead of going to the shelters, went outside and used their iPhones to take videos of the Iron Dome system. And the Iron Dome became a rock star of a defense system in Israel. So everybody who wants to go to the IDF wants to go and work with the Iron Dome because it's cool and it's important. Now, but the situation wasn't all roses because Hamas improved their rockets and their short-range missiles and managed to threaten Tel Aviv. At the time, one of my interns was there and he wrote really interesting experience back to the United States. He was on the bus when the sirens went off. A bus driver wouldn't stop until everyone made enough commotion explaining that it was the siren that was going off. The bus driver would then pull over and open the doors. People would run out and fall to their stomachs, wait for the siren to stop, hear the loud boom, and then race back to the bus before he left them there, if he hadn't already, while they were cowering. And again, imagine this happening over and over. It has this comical quality because we can't really relate to it, but I would feel pretty terrible being on that bus. The Iron Dome managed to change the strategy, how the Hamas went about conducting warfare in 2014 conflict. Again, their arsenal is becoming more sophisticated and better. They are working on salvo launches to increase the probability that they hit target of value, and they're very open about targeting civilians and in fact proud about targeting civilians. They're adapting tactics to conditions on the ground, but the adaptation comes at the cost, which is where the Iron Dome has been beneficial. Obviously, the major benefit is protecting the human lives. But also, if you need salvo launches, you need to smuggle in more inventory, you need to coordinate better, you are causing more moves that the Israelis can look at and hopefully prevent you from even conducting attacks before you do it. Now, okay, we're talking about Israel, and Israel is pretty far away from the United States, and Hamas cannot reach the United States, thankfully. But there are many countries around the world who can, and some of them want to do us harm. North Korea put a satellite in the orbit in 2012, and if the missile scare of the 60s teaches us anything, is that satellite technology is pretty close to long-range ballistic missile technology. They threatened to nuke the United States last year. And again, it has this comical quality to it because of all the places. One of the places was Austin, Texas. Not to pick on Texas, but, you know, San Francisco, Chicago, of course, Washington, D.C., but you're kind of used to it when you live here. So what are the lessons of the Iron Dome, even though the situation is different to some extent? Well, most importantly, opponents of the system often argue that missile defenses are too expensive and we shouldn't be deploying it because incoming missile is much cheaper than the interceptor. Well, it's almost like arguing that you should not be wearing a bulletproof vest because a bullet is much cheaper than the vest. And it's just a stupid analogy. And what the Israeli Iron Dome system shows us is that what you're protecting matters. Besides, at about 8-9 billion a year, missile defense is maybe 1.5% of the DoD budget, an even smaller portion of the federal budget. So you really are getting a lot for your buck. Now imagine for a little bit how much damage would be caused by a successful ballistic missile attack. Or imagine how Americans would react if they had to get off a bus, lay on the ground, wait for the sirens to go off, hear the boom, and get back on the bus. Maybe out of their cars, okay, we don't really use buses here, but imagine the terror. American public would not put up with something like that. Second, and as Tom nicely pointed out, when American lawmakers put their hearts and minds to it, there is a strong bipartisan support for the Israeli missile defense program. For mostly ideological reason originating in the Cold War, it's not the case with U.S. Homeland Missile Defense Program, although it's getting better. We have a law that we will protect ourselves from a limited ballistic missile attack. Interestingly, in the early 90s, limited meant about 200 incoming RVs. Today, we're talking about a handful of missiles of maybe first or whatever rudimentary generation and capability such as North Korea has or Iran can have. Now, the artificial limits are dangerous, obsolete, and inadequate to the security situation we'll be facing. Again, during the Cold War, we assume that you have to give your opponent a free ride, and that protects you from the attack because you can retaliate with overwhelming force. That our own vulnerability would prevent the adversary from attacking. Well, we saw that that assumption is contrary to human nature, because what your adversaries will do, they will find your weak spot and they will exploit it. And there is no doubt in my mind that the interplay between offense and defense will continue in Israel, and we will see how the dynamics plays out and learn from it. But think about it. The North Korean population is 5 inches shorter than South Korean population. There are ads on TV advising North Koreans how to eat grass and make soup out of it because they don't have food. But they invest resources into ballistic missile program. They fly satellites to space. Same with Iran. Incredible inflation due to many rounds of sanctions. Yet it continues to develop both ballistic missile and nuclear weapons program. Even the IAEA is concerned about Iranian nuclear weapon activities. By making ourselves vulnerable to a Soviet attack, which we thought would protect us, we incentivized North Korea's and Iran's of the world to develop capabilities that can hold us hostage and do us harm. We assume that the other side would value human life as we do. That's not the case. The other side prides itself on attacking civilian populations because it serves their political goals better. Additionally, and we've just commemorated 100th anniversary of the First World War, deterrence can fail, and it often does because both parties miscalculate. And that's how all major wars of the 20th century started. Now, better example from daily life. How many times have you told your kids not to touch the stove because the stove is hot? And how many times you were to hand them ice pack later because they didn't listen to you? That's a failure of deterrence for you every day. Now, it was foolish to assume that the Soviets would value same things that we did. Now, it's even more foolish to assume that Iranians and North Koreans or terrorists will value what we do. They don't. We need missile defense, and one of the primary constitutional responsibilities of the federal government is to provide for the common defense. How do we go about it? First, in a similar manner that Israel did, that when it decided it wants to be protected, we need to decide that we want to be protected. Second, we already have missile defense programs in place. We already have technologies in place, and we need to build upon them, and we need to develop them, expand them, and make them better. Especially the Aegis sea-based missile defense system, which is a great capability, but since ships are multi-purpose, we don't have enough of them. We need to integrate different missile defense components. We need to develop radars and satellites that allows us to see what is coming better, see what is coming sooner, give the information back to the ground-based mid-course defense, which is the only system today that protects us from a long-range ballistic missile defense, ballistic missile attacks. We need to make sure that our command and control is such that it allows enough time to intercept a missile, and that we get a second or third shot if the intercept fails for the first time. Lastly, and that's my favorite, eventually we will have to deploy missile defense in space, because quantity and quality of ballistic missiles of our adversaries is improving, and there is no reason to think that it will stop improving. the technological solutions we have today may not be enough to address future threats. Now, thank you very much for the opportunity to share this time with you, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Michaela. I perhaps know why Kim Jong-un threatened Austin, Texas. It could be because the lineup at the South by Southwest Music Festival last year wasn't that good. Don't call me. Okay, next up we have, last but not least, our very own Rebecca Heinrichs. Rebecca, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Good morning. I appreciate the opportunity to be here this morning to talk to you about Iron Dome. And I just wanted to thank especially the congressional staff who are here, because they're the ones that not only have to think about the policy implications, but also have to navigate the political pressures and issues that this Congress must work through together. Missile defense is one of those issues that can be easily ignored by the media. It seems the only real press that it ever gets is if there is a missed intercept or when Iron Dome needs to be deployed, and then we actually get to see what it looks like in battle. And then that gives us an opportunity then to talk about missile defense in general, and then what the United States has, doesn't have, and what the Israelis are doing and what we can learn from them. On July 6th, 2014, Hamas and Islamic Jihad began firing into Israel, importing some, many believe, from Iran, some from Syria, and by some estimates, approximately 40% of the rockets that were used were locally manufactured. This aggression is what prompted Israel to launch Operation Protective Edge, aimed to stop the rocket fire by military and/or diplomatic measures, given the room, basically, that they had to operate because they actually had Iron Dome. Of the 30% of the rockets that Hamas fired into Israel, 30% had good aim. Thankfully, Hamas has terrible aim. The Iron Dome system boasts an 85% success rate. Uzi has it up to about 90%, I think. I think that's what the Israeli government, actually, the official number is 90%, but it's a really good number of those. And to be clear, it's just the rockets that Israel had deemed was headed towards a population center or an area that they want to protect. Only those were the ones that it aimed at, and of those, it had an 85 to 90% success rate. True to the strategy of Hamas, the launchers that they used to launch rockets were located within and near civilian structures, population centers. The UN found some in near schools, buried in playgrounds, hotels, hospitals, that sort of thing, making it very difficult for the Israelis to find out where these rockets actually were being launched from and to get rid of them. As Tom mentioned, I think Michaela did too, the Patriot weapon system deserves some accolade here too, because Patriot successfully shot down at least two UAVs operated by the Israeli government, including a Syrian UAV flying over the Golan Heights. And to Tom's point, that's another one of those weapon systems that's kind of an anti-area, also missile defense system, depending on what it's actually being used for. So I'm just gonna touch on, my colleagues covered a lot. I'm just gonna make 3 points, like a good sermon. I'm gonna give the 3 points right up front and then kind of go through them and then close up. Number one, when dealing with missile defense systems, inventory matters. That's one of the big takeaways we learned from the Israeli conflict, is that inventory matters, and it matters a lot. Number two, cooperation with Israel on military programs, specifically on Iron Dome, has been a good investment for the United States. It's been great for Israel, clearly, but it's also paid off for the United States. Number three, missile defense operations in battle bolster and can help to maintain escalation dominance. I think this is a really important point, because there's a new argument that kind of creeped into the debate a little bit in light of this recent conflict. And so I think that that's an important one. We'll flesh that one out in a minute. Now, back to the inventory and the number of defensive interceptors and why they're so important. As Tom mentioned, it was in August of 2014, divided on other issues. The Congress couldn't agree on anything. All of a sudden, Congress was rushed to session and was asked to plus up. We'd already funded the Israeli missile defense program greatly, and then they needed another $225 million for Iron Dome. The Senate rushed and approved it very easily, and then the House came and then voted for it very, very easily. A vote of 395 to 8, only 8 opposing, in favor of plussing up Iron Dome. Why the rush? It was because Israel was currently in the middle of the conflict and running out of inventory. So it was there was a real pressure cooker going on with the Congress, and the Israeli government came in and made a really big push and needed those interceptors pretty quickly. This goes to Tom's point about, and I'll get to this too a little bit further on, but did it have a deterrent effect into what Hamas was doing? Well, it didn't appear so. Hamas understood that Israel, it looked like, was running out of this Tamir missiles and interceptors, and then continued to just attempt to saturate them with rockets in order to actually use up all of their inventory. Now, this is something I thought as I watched this go on, this is something that the U.S. should take to heart as it considers our own inventory of interceptors for the various systems that comprise the integrated BMDS. For instance, the GMD system, that's the element of the BMDS that protects just the United States homeland against long-range interceptors, we are scheduled to have 44 in place, I think by the end of 2018, I think is the date. Currently we have 30. We were supposed to already have 44 in place during the Bush administration. That was their plan. So when people tell me, well, isn't the Obama administration doing great because he just added 14 more GBIs to in place in Alaska, and I say no, because he's the one that canceled them to begin with, they should already be there. So you don't get credit for doing something late when it should already be done. But there will be 44 GBIs in place. One can surmise that if a missile is headed towards the United States, we're going to shoot more than one GBI at that incoming missile. The particular number isn't one we're going to talk about, but we do know that we're going to shoot more than one. And so you can imagine, do some math pretty quickly, and you can surmise that we're going to exhaust the bullets in our chamber pretty quickly if Iran or North Korea were to determine that it's a good idea and in their interest to attack the United States with ICBMs. Which explains why in wargaming exercises, back when I was on the Hill, I knew that at the time it was General Renouart, who was the commander of Northern Command, had talked to our office about during wargaming exercises, one of the big takeaways was always, we need more GBIs. If you wargame this out, you can understand that in figuring in the calculus of why North Korea or Iran might attack the United States, they're not just going to shoot one or two. Also consider the SM-3 missile inventory. MDA Director Admiral Searing has testified numerous times that the COCOMs want and need more BMD-capable ships. Those ships that are going to be BMD-capable, you can better believe that they're going to need some SM-3 missiles on them. But despite the operational need, now this is based on the threat. This is not just a wish list that the Navy is coming up with. This is looking at the threat, looking at what they've been asked to do. By the administration, they're saying that they need more interceptors. And yet you can see in this last bill, as the budget kind of started crunching down on the commanders, what was the thing that was the bill payer? Interceptors. So this is something that we need to pay attention to and learn from the Israelis, is that inventory matters. Next point, that it's been mutually beneficial and beneficial to the United States. Just two big points on this. As you know, the American company Raytheon and the Israeli company Rafael will begin co-production of the weapon system, which will benefit both countries in pretty significant ways. The first one for the United States is it allows the U.S. much greater access to the Iron Dome data. Now, this is going to benefit other U.S. systems, one can imagine. On September 11, 2012, Undersecretary Frank Kendall said, quote, "The DoD needs to obtain appropriate data rights to Iron Dome technology to ensure us the ability to use the data for U.S. defense purposes and to explore co-production," end quote. That was in 2012. So this is something that the U.S. government recognized was something that would benefit the United States long before this recent conflict, and the conflict just kind of emphasizes how important that point really was. And then the second point, of course, for Israel, is it allows the Israelis to take advantage of the more robust supply chain that the United States enjoys. This will help ensure a bulkier inventory the next time Israel does have to and most certainly will have to deploy the Iron Dome system against Hamas. And on my last point, and I think this is just a matter of policy, and I think it's so important that we understand this and get this right, is on the matter of escalation. Almost always do the objections to missile defense in principle come from the left side of the political spectrum. The arguments, this has been ever since the 80s, they make the same kind of arguments that missile defense is destabilizing. That the stronger the missile defense system is, the more it creates an incentive for the other side to increase its offensive missiles, and then an arms race begins. The defensive system gets stronger, so then the offensive system continues to improve. Or the side with the robust defensive system will feel emboldened to behave more radically, or however it wants, won't be held accountable. So therefore, it's better to have both sides mutually vulnerable to one another. It's better for Hamas, it's better for Israel, if both sides are easily vulnerable. But if you just look at this recent conflict with Hamas, that's just not what happened. One can see that these arguments don't hold up. Lesser developed countries or proxy groups will forever have an incentive to build up missile forces because they don't have the finances to compete with militaries, the militaries of Israel or the military of the United States, with our massive navies and air forces. They don't have the resources to do that. But missiles can pose an asymmetric threat. It's the cheapest way to do it. So that's what they're going to continue to do for the foreseeable future. Despite any lull that you might have a year here, 2 years here, that's what just makes sense for them. That's what they're going to continue to do, regardless of what kind of system we put up to defend against it. They do not build offensive missiles because defensive systems exist. On the contrary, defensive systems may, at some point, if they're strong enough and cheap enough, and this is an important point, one that Tom made well, the system does have to get cheaper. Michaela's absolutely right. This is not a one-for-one ratio. We're not looking at, you know, why in the world would we build an MRAP if we're worried about IEDs, because IEDs are so cheaply made, but they cause great casualties among American forces, and so we're gonna spend the resources to deploy MRAPs. So it doesn't make sense to say that it has to be a one-for-one ratio with cost to cost with a Hamas rocket and an Israeli missile defense system or interceptor. But defensive systems may be at some point one of the stronger ways to deter actors from investing so largely in offensive forces. On the second point, rather than instigating Israel to behave more aggressively, to the contrary, Iron Dome actually allowed Israel more time and opportunity to make decisions about how to handle Hamas. It allowed for various peace proposals. The civilian death toll in Israel consisted of the two citizens, and I think in a Thai guest worker, so there may have been up to three casualties. I'm not sure about that point, but I believe it was three. Had there been no Iron Dome, dozens, perhaps hundreds of civilians may have been killed or severely injured. Civilian Israel and the economy would have grounded to a halt. And as we saw, that's actually not what happened. The Israeli economy actually just kept moving along because of the Iron Dome system. But after this last conflict, there's a new argument that has come, not from the far left, but from those who would like to see Israel becoming more offensive or more militarily aggressive towards Hamas. This argument has come from the other side. I'm so reluctant to say from the right, because I don't think it's totally mainstream here, but it's kind of coming from the angle of being more hawkish. And how this argument goes like this. Actually, I'm going to quote it from an LA Times op-ed. This is what the argument was. If there was footage of shattered buildings in Tel Aviv, if Iron Dome hadn't worked, and the dead and dying lying in the streets of the coastal cities of Ashdod and Ashkelon, few around the world would have condemned Israel for a massive air and ground assault against a palpably murderous Hamas with the aim of destroying it. Over the months needed to pacify and demilitarize Gaza, no doubt protests would emerge, but the protests would have been less strident than they are today. Israel would weather the international indignation far better. Israel would be better understood. In other words, had there been more Israeli casualties, there would have been political pressure on the Israeli government to then go in and use ground forces in to rout Hamas. That's the argument. And it's an argument that I've heard enough times that it concerns me, and I think it's one that needs to be addressed. Had the Israeli government done that, chosen not to deploy the system, even though it has the technological and the resources, the technological ability to do so and the resources to do so, had they chosen not to, Israel would be no different than the enemy at which it's trying to defend itself, using its citizens essentially as human shields. It's exactly what they would have, in order to use as a propaganda effort to see civilians being killed in order to have the clout and the ability to go in there and attack the other side. It simply doesn't make sense for the character of the Israeli government. It's certainly not one that the United States should take hold to, and yet we see this argument also being made for the United States of our nuclear deterrence, and that if we can limit ourselves proactively in future administrations, limit ourselves proactively and not arming ourselves or giving us the ability and the flexibility to make other decisions, that might be a good thing for the United States. It might sort of tie our hands behind our backs, which would be good for everybody involved. It's simply not a good argument, simply not the way you you strategize in order to prepare for conflict. Missile defense allows the country, the host country that has it, to maintain, in classic deterrence parlance, the dominance of the escalation dominance, so that we are actually able to, the United States or Israel, the host country of missile defense, to make decisions. If you have missile defense, it gives you some space, it allows you to decide if you want to use more military force. Nothing was stopping the Israeli government from going in and going and using ground forces to do what they needed to do to Hamas. The missile defense system just allowed them to make that choice without feeling undue pressure, and to protect their citizens in the meantime. So in closing, the Iron Dome system is not the end-all be-all. It's not going to protect the Israeli people indefinitely against any future conflict against Hamas, but it is an excellent tool in the Israeli arsenal, and the U.S. should take advantage of its technical virtues. And perhaps more importantly, the U.S. should take heed of the lessons the latest conflict provide us in the advantages of a truly robust homeland missile defense system, of which we certainly can improve. Thank you.
Rebecca, thank you very much. So thank you to our panel, Tom, Michaela, and Rebecca, for some very stimulating and interesting remarks. I open the floor now up to questions, so if there's any questions, please raise your hand. Helen here has a microphone, and raise your hand, wait for Helen, take the microphone, and then please identify yourself and your affiliation and ask your question. The microphone is working, it just doesn't amplify, so because it's for the video. So I think we have a question here at the front for Pat Host.
Hi, I'm Pat Host with Defense Daily. I was wondering if any of you guys can tell me what the unit cost for an Iron Dome missile is first.
For the Timur missile, it's $50,000.
It started out as about $75,000, and it went down more they
recruited. Okay, well, I'm wondering, with Raytheon signing on and their access to the supply chain, I guess this is for Rebecca, how much do you think that they'll be able to knock down the cost with Raytheon signing on?
That would be a great question for Raytheon, but I think that their contract is probably... it's up to them to talk about that. But $50,000 is my understanding of what those Tamir missiles actually cost for the Israeli government, so presumably much lower than that.
Why do we need Raytheon signing on to get access to the data rights if we're already funding a lot of the program?
That's a good question.
That's a policy question that the Hill, you know, one of the, you know, when I worked on the Hill, one of the things that members of Congress always want to know is if we're going to fund, no matter what it is, no matter what kind of foreign defense system it is, we would like access to the data. That we were not able to obtain that, I know, with the Iron Dome system, but as I said, Undersecretary Kendall made it a priority of his to make sure the United States could learn this, could get it, could obtain it, and could apply it to our own systems.
Thanks.
But it's an important point.
We have a question at the back, I think. Was there a gentleman at the back who wanted to ask a question?
This was a press conference. Iron Dome, because this is more of a statement than a question. First, I want to thank you for an incredible job. So I actually just came back. I was there. I deployed over there to assist the firefighters on the front lines and do some cross-training. So we brought training here during the missile exchange. And there was an interesting observation that the Iron Dome potentially saved more lives of the Gazans, mm-hmm. which is a corollary to what you were saying, save more of their lives because it restrained Israel from doing what they otherwise would have done if they were shattering buildings, blowing up in the streets. We actually toured some of those, and the problem with Israel, you know, is they repair it too fast. So most of the buildings that were hit, and there were some, I was in Ashdod and Ashkelon, and I mean, they were repaired very, very quickly, so we had to get there very soon because even if they aren't blown up, shrapnel can
sure.
catch them on fire and they still have damage. So, and you can't really see even the thousands or hundreds of thousands of the little BBs, right, that are inside those missiles that turn buildings and concrete and then people, of course, into complete Swiss cheese. So the anti-personnel aspects of those as well, which you can't even see unless you're really physically there. But I just want to thank you for your great observations, and I'm happy to give out firsthand accounts because I actually was out there with my cell phone, and I have the video as well, which I shouldn't have been. But we were in armored fire trucks as we were being responding as well. But the other thing that you can't see on TV, even though the missiles are still coming, and you said 30 seconds, and down south you know you only have 15 seconds, if that, is that because you only have 15 seconds and because there's still 10%, right, of the 90%, you still have a little bit of margin. So some of the families were actually living in the shelters for all day, all week, you know, for a month. They were living in the shelters. And so, you know, just like we can't really see the emotional trauma that our soldiers experience when they come back from war, you know, so they say if they, unfortunately, heaven forbid, they lost a limb or something, we understand that, but the emotional trauma, we can't feel that similarly. And in Israel, similarly, we can't feel the emotional trauma of what our life would be like if we were essentially living under siege, what it does to the kids and their mentality and the way they relate to people and their development, to be living in shelter all summer and to be isolated from their normal peer group and to be under that constant threat that any second could be their last.
I'm going to jump in here and just say, here I think there is a commonality in terms of the flexible responses that a very high-tier GMD and a very low-tier Iron Dome provide in terms of call escalation, control, escalation dominance, but just call it a flexible response. Mm. That whether it's some cheap shots of rockets or whether it's some one or two ICBMs. Yes, that's very limited, but in that situation as well, you have greater flexibility in terms of responding left of launch, prior to launch, or immediately after launch. And so there, I think, is one legitimate area of real commonality across the spectrum is flexible response. And it speaks also to the law of armed conflict, our greater expectations for discrimination and humanitarian considerations, as you said, both for Israelis, but also for those folks around the Hamas rockets.
And if I can just say one thing, I think your comments are great. But one thing that if I was going to pick, I would just say that the Iron Dome system didn't restrain Israel. Israel was always a free actor, but it simply just gave them the flexibility to make decisions. So you're exactly right. I mean, I've heard some people say that the Iron Dome system restrained Israel and allowed more Hamas people to live, and that's the argument from the far right saying, then I wish it wasn't there so they could have gone in and routed Hamas. The missile defense system just simply allowed Israel to make those decisions for themselves and gave them greater flexibility, but it didn't. Military systems don't tie our hands or hold our hands. We still have opportunities to be, you know, to make decisions that were best for our country. So.
Restraint to happen. You know, just like we wouldn't hear people start lodging missiles with us, you know, there's the different that decision making.
There's political
process.
Pressures that will right. affect the decisions that the government
yeah.
makes.
And the other difference is there's a distinction. You said the Gaza, and so we wouldn't be killing necessarily the people shooting the missiles. So because they're not necessarily aligned the way we are here. I mean, as you know, the Hamas, the Gazans don't necessarily support Hamas the way we would support our government when we're in a conflict. So they don't speak as one, they're sort of an invading entity as well, as you saw when they rounded the people up as well. So.
We have a question over here.
Hey, is there a lesson here for Poland in Eastern Europe?
I mean, if I'll just say it's Polish and Eastern European descent. If you're living in Eastern Europe, it's not necessarily Iranian missiles only that you're concerned about, but it's also short-range Russian missiles. A couple years ago, we sent a Patriot launcher to Poland. It would have been nice if it actually had missiles in it. And now I think you're seeing renewed interest in Poland and other NATO countries in that, with good reason. Now, the kinds of threats that they're up against are orders of magnitude different than anything we're talking about today. But, and again, I hesitate to say that we can ever get in a position of defense dominance in the near term, but if you want to buy time, if you want to complicate someone who has now nominated themselves an adversary of NATO, and if you want to just give yourself a little bit more space, those are the kinds of things you've been thinking about. You should be thinking about both for air defenses and missile defenses. And the head of the Missile Defense Agency has testified that, I believe it's SM-3, at the very least, could be converted to anti-cruise missile capability, which is of interest.
Perhaps the context is different and a lot broader and more complicated in Europe, because you're not just dealing with Poland or Eastern Europeans, which I think would very well agree on who the problem is, but you're dealing with NATO command and control, you're dealing with alliance, you're dealing with getting everybody to agree, which is different, because in Israel you have non-state actor and a government and citizens. NATO gets a lot more complicated. But I do agree with Tom, in terms of making clear who the real ally is, making a statement sort of geopolitically, pulling yourself away from Russia. I think it's great, and I think it's very important for the US government to continue those deployments, to continue to develop the system, and for the Poles and NATO to support those deployments.
Any other questions? We have three questions at this one table here, so let's start and work our way around.
Okay. I'm curious to know what technical contributions the Israelis made to the implementation of the Iron Dome system beyond the technical contributions that came from this country.
Yeah. The system...
They funded it, but it was Rafael. Rafael.
And in fact, when they first came to the U.S. with the concept, because their interceptors are blast fragmentation, they're not hit to kill as the U.S., the U.S. engineers said, this cannot be done, we can't help you. And so the Israelis went and developed the system.
With U.S. funding. But yeah.
With U.S. funding.
No, the first funding was all Israeli.
Yeah.
The second tranche after 2006 was with American funding this last year.
Ben from CSP.
Hi, Ben Lerner from Center for Security Policy. This is admittedly slightly outside the lane, but can any of you comment on the development of Iron Beam, the difference between beam versus dome, and the significance of Iron Beam for dealing not only with missiles, but also increasingly with unmanned aerial vehicles being developed by Iran and then, as we see, deployed by Hezbollah and Hamas?
I don't know the technical details.
Oh, well, I mentioned Iron Beam. As a concept, I was emphasized the concept side of things, and I mentioned the use of directed energy on UAVs. This is, and I would bracket that and kind of put it in the context of how I presented it, which is very low level stuff. You're already seeing this. You're already seeing it on vehicles, you're seeing ships, including new naval ships, and I think you're going to see a lot more of it. There's lots of concepts out there, there's lots of ideas for programs out there for putting it on predators, for putting iron beam is, I believe, more akin to fell, a ground-based directed energy that keeps bats bouncing around for a long time. But I think in a way we're already there in terms of the ideas, and it's just a matter of getting it out.
If I can just make one comment on just future technologies in general. Undersecretary Kendall just, he's been kind of going around, he gave a big speech, and then I know he's been briefing the Senate and Armed Services Committees on this new initiative to develop newer, cutting-edge, better technologies, because the United States' strategic advantage is actually being diminished. And the actor that he is using most to describe this diminishing of the strategic advantage the United States has had for so long is China. And so it is going to be technologies like directed energy, et cetera, that industry is now being called to do and to come up with. Now, that's not to imply that industry wouldn't have already been doing this if the funding hadn't already been cut back when this administration came into office, because all of those future programs that were already built into the budget from the previous administration to actually stay ahead of the threat, those were the first to go when this administration came into office. But it's an important point. And the United States needs to, again, kind of take a page out of the Israeli playbook and say, no, there's a threat that's developing. We don't have time to even discuss, you know, the political pros and cons. There's a threat. Let's work to develop a defense against it before it's upon us.
And question there.
At Michael Sobluk from Senator Cruz's office. My question gets to putting this in the context of the administration's effort of Global Zero. And a number of you touched on this, where there's a disconnect between support for Iron Dome and opposition to U.S. missile defense systems. So in the context where, granted, it's a long-term ambition of the administration, but it's a stated goal of ridding the world of nuclear weapons, what are some practical ways from your perspective that the bridge or the gap can be bridged between support for these smaller regional defense systems to maybe larger systems that the U.S. can use?
Go ahead.
When I talk about this, I always, this is probably the most important thing that we can take away here. You know, I see short-term goals, the low-hanging fruit that we can absolutely do. They're bipartisan. They're things that we absolutely need to improve upon. And I think that even possibly this administration maybe can get behind, especially if there are two chambers in Congress that are supportive of these efforts. And some of that Tom mentioned, especially when talking about Europe, Russia's developing and explicitly threatening Europe with nuclear weapons, with cruise missiles. And so there might be an opportunity here to say, for the longest time, the United States has purposely limited ourselves and what we did with NATO to not place any defensive system in Europe that could be even seen or perceived to defend against Russian missiles. I think that we've gotten to the point now, especially after Ukraine, et cetera, where we can say that doesn't really make sense anymore. If the Poles want a particular weapon system, if NATO wants a particular weapon system and the Russians aren't happy with it, we might be able to come together and actually start deploying these perfectly reasonable, already in existence defensive systems. That's an achievable thing, I think. In the long term, Michaela talked about this in her last point, is eventually we do need to have more sophisticated weapon systems that are utilizing directed energy. We currently do not have a boost phase missile defense layer in our system. That's the phase of the missile's trajectory there that you get it right in the early stages before it can launch counter measures, et cetera. And we need to develop that. And that's going to require a big political kind of movement and initiative on the part of the American people and the part of a future administration to say, you know what, maybe we do need to explore boost phase missile defense from the platform of space. And I think that that's something that we need to start talking about more vigorously as a country. That's the long term. That's kind of the big goal I think it's important, especially if you want to get rid of nuclear weapons, if you want to decrease the number of nuclear weapons, which I don't suggest that we should be doing anymore at this point. I always tell people the administration wanted to cut down on the world's nuclear weapons, but the only ones he could actually get rid of are ours. So those are the ones he targeted, and that's what he's done. But it doesn't make sense, especially now we know that the Russians are cheating on INF, et cetera, to forge another arms control treaty. So, but if you do want to kind of release a little bit of our dependence on nuclear weapons, you have got to build up defenses better than they are. And we're simply not doing that at all to the point where it makes sense.
Let me maybe take this on from slightly a different angle. Some Europeans think that if you deploy missile defense, you're fine and you can take US weapons away from Europe and you can reduce the arsenal. Well, the interesting thing that philosophically the nuclear zero camp is the same people who hate US missile defense or any kind of missile defense and consider it destabilizing. So you really have philosophical disconnect, which I think is impossible to bridge. You cannot advocate for missile defense and the intellectual kind of history is just not there. Outside of the dilemma, there are other good reasons why we should keep nuclear weapons in Europe and why we should modernize our nuclear weapons that nuclear zero crowd would not agree on, but.
Well, I would say notwithstanding some sociological connections between the global zero and missile defense opponents, the connections are actually very few and far between. Those really are pretty separate questions. The folks who see the missile defenses that we're pursuing now as destabilizing, I would say put too much faith in the near-term application of Ronald Reagan's hope that missile defense could make nuclear weapons obsolete. It hasn't done it, and we're not going to be positioned to make our nuclear force obsolete anytime soon, and we shouldn't try. But there are a few lessons here. And even if we don't get to defense dominance, it helps us with flexible response. And that does have a connection to the nuclear side of things.
We have time for one more question. Okay, one more question, and I saw the gentleman at the very back put his hand up first, so my apologies to the others. I'd ask you to ask your questions in the after the event. Thank you.
Matt Knight, British Embassy. Michaela, you mentioned that space-based systems would be essential for future threat. How far along the line do you think we'll be before we see a space-based BMD system? And what would you say about the international treaty agreements that we've got about space and weaponization?
All right. So with sequestration, we're not going to go anywhere in the next several years. So that's an easy, short answer. Technologically, we validated many technologies that would contribute towards space-based interceptor in the Clementine mission back in the early 90s. In terms of treaties about weaponization in space, you are putting interceptors there for defensive purposes. They do not have offensive role, and you can design them in a way that they would not have offensive role.
And I would just say, whenever I made my remarks, that as Michaela said, it doesn't appear, certainly there's going to be technological issues that we're going to have to work out, but the Institute for Defense Analysis has already come out saying that it would be possible, that it actually would be not cost prohibitive for the United States economy to do this, etc. The way I see it, the big giant obstacle for us to do this is the political obstacle. So, and I don't think it's a small one. I think it's an enormous one. So I'm not trying to make it seem easier than it is, but I do think that in terms of our long-term objective for what the United States can do based on the gentleman from Senator Cruz's office's question, is that that's the direction we need to be going. And, it takes a big national conversation to move the needle on something like that, and that's why I'd say that we should start talking about it. But it is—it's not a matter of cost. It's not, and as a matter of fact, that IDA study that I have in my mind too even said that there's no current treaty that would prohibit the United States from doing that. And I would argue that we should make sure that we're not signing on to treaties that would prohibit us from doing that.
But what I would say is that we're not even thinking about that now. We're not even thinking about, let's just say, the whole set of next generation technologies. And this is why I think Rebecca's citing Frank Kendall on, okay, now we've got to go back and reinvest in some of this stuff. Because guess what? We not only have done sequestration, not only have, say, cut GMD budget in half since 2009, but actually, going back even before 2009, we've been on hold for, you might say, qualitative improvements of our current system, qualitative next-generation technologies, going back to about sort of 2006, 2007 period. So I would say is we got the sequestration, we got budgets, we got folks on the left and right that are not even thinking about putting dollars after things like that. And I was sort of chafing a little bit at the $225 million that we threw into Iron Dome very quickly. But guess what? It's a big deal that MDA managed to pull together $99.5 million for redesign of the kill vehicle for GMD. That's a big deal. And that represents a shift that we're actually starting to think about the next generation as opposed to just keeping what we got in the silos. So we're not anywhere close to that stuff, but let's changing the culture, be thinking about improving what we've got and evolving what we've got. That's the second and third tier steps we have to take before we get to that stuff.
And I just want to underscore what Tom just said and put a fine point on that. On the GMD system in particular, you know, we just talked about how it was a pretty big deal, a pretty big lift, political lift, to get that extra $99.5 million for the kill vehicle for GMD. But it should not have been. The GMD system, the whole reason it was even deployed under the Bush administration was it was supposed to be constantly evolving. It was never supposed to be just stuck in the ground and just sat there as a completed system. And so here we are, you know, everybody wants to beat up on GMD when there's a missed intercept, but it's hard to blame the system in itself when you continue to cut funding and then you just expect it to perform perfectly. So as Tom said, We have a very, very good, limited, albeit limited, ballistic missile defense system for the United States. We need to make sure it's the best that it can be. We need to improve upon it. But as I suggested, we cannot just be reactionary to what's going on in the world. We have to look forward over the horizon and make sure that we're staying on top of things, which is why I think Undersecretary Kendall's remarks have been so incredibly important the last few months.
Okay, and I'd just like to reiterate, actually, that there are no treaty limitations to space-based missile defense. The only treaty that prevents placement of any weapons is the Outer Space Treaty, and they specifically prevent the placement of nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons. All other weapon systems are actually de facto allowed. There is a treaty currently proposed by the Russian Federation and China, the PPWT, Prevention of Weapons in Outer Space Treaty, designed specifically to actually try and restrain U.S. actions in missile defense, but actually does not address actual current threats to space systems, actually ironically fielded by China and increasingly by Russia. So in terms of the treaty issue, that's almost, if you will, a non-issue right now. It may become one, obviously, in the years to come if we go down that way. So I'm afraid we're going to have to wrap things up because Tom has to run off to another appointment. But I'd like to first of all thank our panel, so please join me in thanking our panel for a very stimulating conversation. Tom Carrico, Michaela Dodge, and Rebecca Heinrichs. Thank you all for coming out in such miserable weather, which I see is kind of clearing up now, so I hope those who bowed out now regret it. I'm sure they will when they see the video. I'd like to thank also members of staff from the British Embassy and the Russian Embassy for joining us, as well as also our friends from the staff in Congress as well as also the rest of you for coming out. And the video for this event will be posted by the end of the week, certainly by Friday afternoon. Please also check out our Missile Threats website, missilethreat.com. Started by our friend Tom Carrico and also helped by Rebecca Heinrichs. And I was part of the team that was the precursor to all that. at CDIS, the Center for Defense and International Security Studies at the University of Lancaster in UK. And now we've all come full circle years later, purely by coincidence, and we're now together. And the Marshall Institute is very proud to be hosting today the missile threat website. So please do check that out. It is the resource on missile defense and missile threat issues. And please do check that out. Also, look out for our expanded program in the coming 12 months on missile threats, but also space, cyberspace, missile threats, missile defense, nuclear issues. We're trying to bring a more holistic picture to the emerging threats in all those areas into a larger strategic framework, and I hope you'll be able to join us for those events in the future. And I know I'll be calling on our friends here again to help us out on those issues. So again, thank you. If you have any further questions for our panelists, please come and see them up front, but be aware that Tom has to leave soon. So again, thank you.
Thank you, John.